Welcome. I'm glad you're all here. And So this, as you know, is entitled something like Language versus Ideas or something. Is this right? Okay. So this is the way it started. I've been thinking a lot about language, and often people have said to me, "What matters to you about writing? What do you think is the most important thing? Do you read for character? Do you read for plot?" And I find myself saying, I'm a sentence person. I read for sentences. That what matters to me is the language, the actual word on the page. So as some of you may know, I wrote a book called Reading Like a Writer that's all about slowing down and reading for language. And that's the way I teach. I teach at Bard College one semester a year, and it's a literature class. And it's a close reading class. So what we do in class is, I love it because it's like my own personal book group, except I don't have to be democratic about what, we don't have to take turns. I mean, I get to say what we all read. And in class, I'll take a story, some kind of text that I like, that I care about, and we'll just go over it word by word, line by line. Can everybody hear me? Sentence by sentence. And just say, why this word? Why not another word? Why a semicolon instead of a period? Why a comma? I mean, just the most nitty-gritty mechanics of language. The idea about language versus idea started because I think that one of the ways that literature is taught that makes it hard for people and for especially young readers is literature is taught as if writers always start out, or often start out, with a big idea. As if Melville said, I think I'll talk about the problem of evil. So let me see if I can think of a symbol for evil. Oh yeah, white whale, right? Well, that's not how Moby Dick got written, insofar as I can tell. I mean, it began with a story about Captain Ahab and so forth. And then beyond that, if you read Moby Dick, what you're carried away by and what elevates it beyond the realm of just any old story about whaling is the language, is Melville's language. And in fact, if you read, how many of you have read, just out of curiosity, Moby Dick? Oh, I'm in heaven. Well, I'm not in an MFA program. just the language and the rhythms of Father Mapple's sermon. When he gets up and delivers that sermon, it sets the entire book up. Everything he says in that sermon just sets the book up. And it's the language of the sermon. It's the rhetoric of the sermon. It's the rhythm of the sermon. It's the words on the page. And that's what matters to me, language. And in my own experience, when I'm trying to write a character and I've mostly written, this most recent book that I have out, it's a different story. But I've mostly written in close third person, which is, disguised first person, basically, because it's you're inside the consciousness of the character, except you're calling the character by the name of the character. You all know what I'm saying, right? And people say, well, how do you get a character? How do you find a character? How do you enter the consciousness of a character? Well, for me, when you're writing close third person, and also when you write in first person, what you're hearing or what you're putting on the page is the language that the character uses talking to him or herself inside him or her own head, right? I mean, that's because we all do that. You walk through the day and you're running through a kind of monologue in your head, and it takes place, sometimes I find myself talking out loud, but mostly it's silent. And there's language involved. You're actually talking to yourself in your head. And for me, the key to a character is the language that the character is using inside the character's head. And it's also a key to what I care about in writing and what moves me in writing. I was thinking the other day, I'm going down to New Orleans soon, and I'm reading with a young writer who I've never met, who's become a sort of protege, I guess. And because he won a literary contest that I judged. And usually, judging these contests, sometimes it can be good, sometimes it's discouraging. But this one, he was the clear winner. And the reason was he'd written this story collection. And his name is Michael Jeffrey Lee, I think. And the story collection is called Something in My Eye, published by Sarah Band Books. He'd written a story collection. And in one of the stories, there's a character who's working in an office, in an office building, and someone jumps off the roof of the office building, and he sees the shadow of the guy falling. And then someone comes into his office and says, did you see the guy jump? And he says, yes, even though he didn't, he just saw the shadow. And then because he is the character he is, I mean, that is the narrator of the story, not the writer, because he's the character, he feels so guilty about having lied about the guy that jumped off the thing that he quits his job and he moves to this other town and checks into a motel by the side of the highway. And he gets on a bus, he's looking for jobs, he can't find a job, and he realizes that he's cut himself shaving and that he's sort of wadded his face with paper. And the line that got to me, I mean, the reason why this guy won the contest is something like, because the motel had complimentary toilet paper. And it was that phrase, complimentary toilet paper, I went, okay, you got it. You know, it was just weird. And it was everything that that word suggested. I mean, the weirdness of it and the strangeness and that, you know, I mean, and what would not complimentary toilet, you know, charging, I mean, what would the opposite be? So the peculiarity of that character and the strange way he looked at the world was all conveyed by language. It was just language. So it wasn't like, you know, I have an idea, I'm going to write a story about a very strange character, you know, blah, blah. I'm going to write a story about a character, and this is the language that the character uses inside his head, and part of that language says complimentary toilet paper. It blew me away. And, I mean, apparently, I'm going to meet him, apparently the guy is quite as strange as his writing, but that wasn't part of it. So I just wanted to read you examples. Oh, and then the opposite. I mean, when I don't like a book, or when I, you know, a lot of books just come in my house and they just show up, and I usually look at, you know, I'll read a couple of pages, and often I'll decide to go on, or I'll decide not to go on, whatever. And I, you know, just because I've started paying attention, I notice that almost always it's questions of language that make me stop or start. And when I'm reviewing a book, I have no choice. I have to read it all the way through, language or no language. And often what I find myself, again, responding to is language. So some of you may have read this. I apparently wrote, well, one of two negative reviews of The Goldfinch. This was in the New York Review of Books. And then when Don Tart won the Pulitzer Prize, all these reporters were calling me up and saying, would I comment? Like, what was I, you know, I was like dodging, like, what was I gonna say? She didn't deserve it, you know? At that point, there was nothing left to say. I said, well, I wrote the review. But the thing that I found myself responding to that I didn't like, and the reason why I found the book more of a chore than the 2 million people that have bought it so far, was questions of language. And in fact, I have to say that the one sort of cheering thing for me that came out of this was that I got something like 200 emails, most of them from strangers. I mean, some from like high school friends I had here, but most of them from strangers writing to my Bard webmail, which I never checked, but in this case I started looking, and 200. And one of them said, she's a genius, you're an idiot, you don't get it. And 199 said, you know, I'm approximately, but said, I thought I was the only person in my town that thought this book was bad. I felt I was all alone here. There were sentences that I picked out that were, again, questions of language, questions of sensibility that just seemed so bogus to me. I mean, at the point at which I thought I could hardly go on and except that I was getting paid to go on. The narrator is talking about his mother, and he says something about, because of the way she looked, people often guessed that she was Icelandic. And I thought, really, how often did that happen? I can't imagine. Once. Do they know, you know, are you Icelandic? What would they even mean? I mean, so, you know, and there's sort of a level of bogusness. So I thought I would start off just by a negative example. Just reading you, just some of the, speaking of language, we could do the bad news first. An example, let me see if I can find it, of the kind of language that turned me against, apparently, alone in the world except for James Wood, and 200 people wrote me, the goldfinch. And again, it's questions of language. And the way language works itself out through, I mean, it's not just words, it's detail, it's observation, it's what you put on, you know, it's what you put on the page. So here's here's a couple of things. And again, some of you may have read this, I apologize. Here we go. And, you know, and I've been thinking about it because I've been traveling a lot and I've been thinking, okay, you know, as some of you must think all the time, how would I describe this that wouldn't be just generic or just one cliche on top of the other? Because the first thing that pops into your head, I think everybody's head, are cliches. I mean, you know, a friend of mine said that one of the reasons that writing a first draft is so exhausting, and it is. And I mean, I think I used to think it burns calories, but I don't think that it does, unfortunately. But it's that you're fending off these cliches. They're just coming at you, and you're trying not to use them. So it's like almost a physical effort to get the cliches out of your mind, or the generic, you know. The generic way. So here's, I'll just read you some examples. All right, so here's a description of, here's just some bad writing. I'll just read it to you. Here we go. So he's talking about this painting, the painting of the goldfinch. Here we go. And he's talking about the painting. I liked knowing it was there for the depth and solidity it gave things, the reinforcement to infrastructure, an invisible bedrock rightness that reassured me just as it was reassuring to know that far away whales swam untroubled in Baltic waters and monks in arcane time zones chanted ceaselessly for the salvation of the world. You know, and like, how did we get from the bedrock rightness to the whales swam untroubled in Baltic to art? What what is an arcane time zone? What is an arcane time zone? I mean, they're distant time zones, but arcane means arcane. It doesn't mean distant. All right. Then there's only a tiny heartbeat and solitude, bright and sunny wall, and a sense of no escape. Time that doesn't move. Time that couldn't be called time. Well, what else would you call it, if you can call it? You know, again, it's just language. It's just language. So I'll try and find one more. All right, this is just an obvious example. Again, a quote. Often in the afternoons, perfume-smelling women with shopping bags drop by for coffee and tea. In the evenings, couple dressed for dinner, congregated over wine and fizzy water in the living room where the flower-rich opera set, where the flower arrangements were delivered every week from a swanky Madison Avenue florist and the newest issue of Architectural Digest and the New Yorker were found just on the top of the coffee table. Well, on one hand, it's like, you know, get me an Upper East Side living room from Central Casting or something like, you know, is there anybody, you wouldn't even have to go to an Upper East Side living room to write this because, you know, and then what does perfume-smelling women mean? Did they smell of perfume or were they actually smelling perfume, you know, like when they walked in? So, you know, anyway, so I won't, again, horrify you but I will read you another example, I just think it's sort of bad magic to read the bad one, but here's a good one because she talks at some length about, you know, many of you may have read the book. Our hero becomes a drug addict in the middle of the book, and I'll read you her example. I can't resist. I'm sorry. This is from the Goldfinch, the description of drug addiction, the good and bad effects of pharmaceuticals. Quote, it was a myth you couldn't function on opiates. Shooting up was one thing, but for someone like me, jumping at pigeons, beating from the sidewalk, afflicted with post-traumatic stress disorder, practically to the point of spasticity and cerebral palsy, pills were the key to being not only competent, but high functioning. Now, it stopped me, matters of language, thinking at what point does post-traumatic stress disorder shade over into cerebral palsy? I mean, they don't even have the same symptoms, as far as I know. They're just not the same thing. You know, so, and I thought, bad description of but, and then I couldn't resist. Here's, this is from a wonderful writer, the British writer Edward St. Aubin, who wrote this terrific series of the Patrick Melrose novels, dark, but really beautiful and beautifully written, and in which there's a similar situation. A young man who's addicted to heroin is walking the streets of New York City. Here's how he describes, again, just language, same situation. Okay, exact same situation. The differences I'm trying to point out are differences of language. So here's Edward St. Aubin on the same situation. Quote, heroin was the only thing that really worked, the only thing that stopped him scampering around in a hamster's wheel of unanswerable questions. Heroin was the cavalry. Heroin was the missing chair leg, made with such precision that it matched every splinter of the brake. Heroin landed purring at the base of his skull and wrapped itself darkly around his nervous system like a black cat curling up on its favorite cushion. It was as soft and rich as the throat of a wood pigeon or the splash of sealing wax onto a page or a handful of gems slipping from palm to palm. The way other people felt about love, he felt about heroin. And he felt about love the way other people felt about heroin, that it was a dangerous and incomprehensible waste of time. Well, you know, you couldn't, I mean, there it is, one metaphor after another, just stacked on top of the other. But, you know, and nothing is riskier and more dangerous than to have eight metaphors in the same sentence. Try it sometime. It's really, you know, a tightrope walk. But he does it. I mean, because they all make sense. They're all beautiful. When you, if you stop and think about any one of them, they, it makes perfect sense. You can understand it. And it's not, you don't have this feeling like, where is he getting this? You know, because you know where he's getting it, because it's so, it's beautiful and logical at the same time, which is a very hard, and then, you know, to end it with this sort of weird aphorism about heroin and love, it's just, you know, it's just kind of a beautiful way. So I brought you, just again, because they're sort of a pleasure to read, I just wanted to read you things that I think are examples of language used well. And in writing this book, some of it began as lectures that I gave, you know, because I had to for writers' conferences and stuff. And so I decided to organize it like words, sentences, paragraphs. Paragraphs. Turned out no one had written anything about paragraphs. I went, you know, that's sort of an interesting topic. And I wrote the book. I wrote the book like Tom Sawyer painting the fence. I mean, I just, you know, emailed my friends and said, okay, who's your favorite sentence writer? And then they would write back and I would steal whatever they said. So this is a sentence. Again, a very long sentence. I mean, it's, you know, now we sort of think, I mean, once I was teaching one of the less, it was in an MFA program, which I don't do anymore, and I was teaching the great novella by Heinrich von Kleist, the German writer, and who writes these, I'll try and find it in here, these beautiful, complex sentences, and my students said, you can't do that in English. You can't write complex sentences. You can only read it, do it in German. And I went, yeah, but we're reading it in English, so why would that be true? So here's, it's actually my favorite sentence in the book, and it's not by me. It's by Virginia Woolf. And the thing I like about the sentence, one of them, is that it's 181 words long. And it's a long sentence. Okay, so this is the opening of Virginia Woolf's essay called On Being Ill. And listen to it. I mean, and it's not just the precision of the language, and it's precise, but it's the rhythm, it's the sonority, it's the cadences, it's the meaning. I mean, just, you know, it's a pleasure. Considering how common illness is, how tremendous the spiritual change that it brings, how astonishing when the lights of health go down, the undiscovered countries that are then disclosed, what wastes and deserts of the soul a slight attack of influenza brings to view, what precipices and lawns sprinkled with bright flowers a little rise of temperature reveals, what ancient and obdurate oaks are uprooted in us by an act of sickness, how we go down into the pit of death and feel the waters of annihilation close above our heads and wake thinking to find ourselves in the presence of the angels and the harpers when we have a tooth out and come to the surface in the dentist's armchair and confuse his rinse the mouth, with the greeting of the deity stooping from the floor of heaven to welcome us. When we think of this, as we are so frequently forced to think of it, it becomes strange indeed that illness has not taken its place with love and battle and jealousy among the prime themes of literature. Mm. 181 words, wow, right? It doesn't get any better than that. It's so beautiful. It's so beautiful and so clear. And so, you know, and everything, I mean, now, of course, people rarely study grammar, a big mistake. I mean, when I was a kid, we had to diagram sentences, and it was incredibly useful because you learn simple things, not stupid things, like what noun the phrase modifies, important to know. Or, you know, again, what could be more basic and more essential, subject-verb agreement, remember that, some of you? I mean, important, because why are they important? Not just because there are a bunch of stupid rules, but because it's about clarity. And the most important thing, it seems to me, I mean, more important than anything else, than more important than anything, is clarity. What does it mean? You know, what is this? And often, when I'm working with students, as I said, I teach a literature class and not a writing class, but I still ask my students to send me every week a response paper to the text we're reading. And when I have students that are having trouble writing, often the thing I do is just say to them, sit down with them and say to them, okay, what does this sentence mean? What are you trying to say? And they can always explain it. It always makes sense. They know what it means, but somehow, and I don't know, you know, it's partly because a weird thing happens to people when they think they're writing, as opposed, you know, they go, I'm writing now, you know. And they just sort of forget some natural impulse toward clarity and communication just goes out the window. So they say it, and it's always clear. And then I say, well, why don't you just write the thing that you just said? I mean, I had an experience once, a friend of mine, who's a writer, a film critic, her son got a job writing a piece of criticism for what was then the Village Voice, and it was a review of the feature-length version of the Inspector Gadget cartoon. You know, I mean, feature-length cartoon Inspector Gadget, and her son, who was this wonderful kid, had just graduated from Brown, which is really big on theory, and you know, so he wrote this review for the Village Voice about Inspector Gadget, like this sort of semiotics essay. It was completely impenetrable, completely. And my friend said, I can't talk to him, I'm his mother. Why don't you talk to him? So I said, sure. So he came over, and I just went through it and said, what does this sentence mean? And he had to translate it back from language of semiotics in English, really. And by the time we got through, believe me, it was a long process, he had this perfectly terrific, smart, interesting little review of Inspector Gadget, but it was at least understandable to someone who might read it. So I'll read you one more sentence, which again, I mentioned Kleist. Let me see if I can find it. You know, I could just read you all these sentences. I mean, they're so, you know, one of the pleasures of writing this book was I just got to copy down great sentences by writers I admired, and I can't, you know, it's worth doing, just copying. I mean, we had a teacher in eighth grade who made us copy. We had to copy an entire Flannery O'Connor story, and we thought she was just an idiot. But now, I'm grateful. And when I would find, after I would copy these things, my writing would get better for a little while. You know, wear off after a while. But and then there's sentences that I like that I'll teach an entire story just to be able to read aloud to my class the last, you know, James Joyce's The Dead is a perfect example, or John Cheever's Goodbye, My Brother, and these beautiful, beautiful, and, you know, things to pay attention to. Again, rhythm and rhetoric. I mean, you know, when I teach, and it makes these sort of strange connections that are nonetheless interesting connections. When I teach the ending of Goodbye, My Brother, or the Goodbye, My Brother, which some of you may know is about this New England family getting together for this family. How many of you have read it? Any of you read it? Oh, it's a great story. This New England family gets together. Dysfunctional, I mean, a word I don't like anyway, but it just doesn't even touch it, what's going on. I mean, they're really awful. And there's this kind of prodigal brother who they all hate. But basically, they're all just projecting onto the brother. So, and then the end has this gorgeous sentence that has, the story has a kind of religious theme, I mean, because it's partly about Puritan New England, so it has a kind of sermon running through. The last two paragraphs have the rhythms of a sermon. They're very, very beautiful. And one of the things I like to do, although I had to stop it because I kept bursting into tears, which is embarrassing when you're teaching, is to read to them the, what is it? I have been to the mountain. It's the Martin Luther King's last sermon, because of the rhythm of it. Because some of you may know this. I mean, the famous part is I've been to the mountain, you know, blah, blah, I've seen that. But there's this other part, which is, again, the rhythm of the sermon, the rhythm of the preacher. And he's talking about, there was some of you, again, probably know this. There was an earlier assassination attempt. He was signing books or something, and a woman came up to him and said, "Are you Dr. King?" And he said, "Yes." And she stabbed him with a penknife. And it went into his chest. And the doctors said, they rushed him to the hospital, and the doctors said, if you had sneezed, you would have died. And he proceeds to give the entire history of the civil rights movement in this rhetoric, and it's, if I had sneezed, I would have missed the blah, blah, blah. If I had sneezed, I never would have blah, blah, blah. If I had sneezed, and it's the rhetoric of the sermon, and it's so beautiful, and it's so rhythmic, and it's weirdly like the end of the John Cheever story. You can't imagine two more different writers than Martin Luther King and John Cheever, but there it is. You know, and also it's part of the American tradition. I mean, we come from a tradition of sermons and preachers. Let me recommend to you, there's the Library of America has a book called American Sermons, and it goes all the way up from the earliest Puritan sermons to Martin Luther King. And if you want to find out what's happened in this country and, you know, our history, it's one of the best ways of figuring out, just from reading the sermon. So, let me see if I can find this. Well, I think it's here. This is, I mentioned teaching this great novella by von Kleist. And this is the first sentence. It's a great first sentence. I think someone or me would have been smart enough to put an index here. Oh, here it is. So it's von Kleist's novella, The Marquise of O. And Kafka said that he learned to write first sentences by reading von Kleist, because, you know, Gregor Samsa woke one night from a night of troubled dreams to find that he had been, one morning from a night of troubled dreams to find that he had been transformed in his bed into a giant insect. Great sentence. So here's the first sentence of The Marquise of O. And again, you know, when I teach, I like to teach this story because it's very complicated. It's extremely morally ambiguous. I mean, I won't spoil it for you, but by the end you find yourself thinking things that you didn't think you thought, and you still are not sure you think. You're just persuaded of them. Anyway, this is how it begins. So in my classes, we just take the sentence apart. But here it is, undissected. One sentence. In M, a large town in northern Italy, the widowed Marquise of O, a lady of unblemished reputation, and the mother of several well-bred children, published the following notice in the newspapers, that, without her knowing how, she was in the family way, that she would like the father of the child she was going to bear to report himself, and that her mind was made up, out of consideration for her people, to marry him. You know, I mean, how could you not go on reading something that begins that, you know, and it just gets stranger and stranger. I mean, you know, but the things he puts in, the fact that she's the mother of already two children, presumably she knows how children are conceived, the fact that she's has an unblemished reputation, and the fact that out of consideration for her people, she's made up her mind to, I mean, it's all, you know, it just reads like a sentence, but it's so dense, and it's so beautiful, and it's so packed with information that becomes important later in the story. And again, you know, it's just language. I mean, it's in translation, so we're dealing with something else here. But it, you know, and I think Kleist started with that sentence. I mean, I know that he started with that sentence. That was the first sentence that probably was fine. So that's my long, you know, my long whatever winded. And I just like to hear any questions people had, and we can all talk and know, talk to each other. This is a kind of a class. I have to put my glasses on so I can actually see you again, because you've all disappeared. Yeah.
Is it a question of language so much as it's a question of sensibility? Now, maybe you have to present the sensibility through language, and the words you choose are determined by the sensibility.
I think it's both. I think it's hard to tease them apart, language and sensibility. But I also think it's important, the thing that's important to realize is language, if we're writing, that's what we're using. That's the only tool we have, really. We can't, you know, I don't know about the rest of you, I can't draw. There's no other way I can communicate. And the difference in language, I mean, one of the example I always use is, it's much clearer to people when you talk about visual art. I mean, that is, if you talk about what's the difference between Van Gogh's sunflowers and a picture of a flower that a kindergartner drew? Or what's the difference between that last beautiful painting of Van Gogh with the crows over the field? And, you know, my granddaughter, who's 7, can draw birds pretty well. She's learned, like, blah, blah. You know, and she's not Van Gogh. So the difference is not subject matter. It's the same subject matter. It's the way it's done. And for us, it's language. Yeah.
It's the same that you were saying about your friend's son from Brown.
Mm-hmm.
I find that when I read a catalog of art, a beautifully produced catalog, even mm-hmm. by the Met or Yale University Press, the curator is fantastic in creating the exhibit, but totally obfuscates with the language.
With jargon.
With our jargon. Yeah. Total jargon. Yeah. You cannot understand a word. If you try to analyze a sentence or a paragraph, it's
you
impossible.
Can't understand it.
It's impossible.
I know.
You have to paraphrase it in your own mind
if
to
you
be
can.
Able to write
if you,
it. Yes.
If you can. Well, you know, it's. I'm glad you said that. I mean, one of those of you who teach or might ever teach, one of the exercises I do in class is I ask my students to bring in a passage of jargon. I mean, and it's, for some strange reason, art criticism has more
it's
than
the
anything.
Worst.
It's the worst, right? But I, you know, whatever you want, art criticism, history, literary criticism, bring in a passage that's just pure, thick jargon, and then translate it into English, and read the two together. And what happens, first of all, is the jargon passage just collapses like a big meringue,
that's
because
right.
usually there's not that much...
Nothing, it's all
not,
air.
Yeah, it's all air, right? And but for my students... Even by the time I get them, these are undergraduates, have been taught to try and write in jargon. I don't know why, it's somehow. So the minute that they see that...
It's because they're not doing the exercises, the grammar exercises that
I think
you mentioned.
I think that's right. So the minute they do that, the minute they take the jargon passage and translate it into English, their writing improves the next week. It's like a miracle. I mean, I wrote art criticism for a while and for the Wall Street Journal, and... I'm not an art critic. I mean, I'm married to a painter, so I look at art a lot, but I'm not an art critic. And I said to the editor who hired me, I'm not an art critic. And he said, yeah, but you can write lucidly, and I can't get an art critic to do that. So so the first assignment I had, art critics in the room, I'm sorry, I'm sure. The first assignment I had was to write about it. There was a show of David Smith's sculptures at Storm King. And I'm a huge fan of David Smith's work. And I went to the local public library, this is upstate New York, and I got a book by Rosalind Krauss, a very well-known art critic, who just writes nonstop jargon. And I remember clearly, this was like 20 years ago, my husband was driving, and I was reading it in the car, and tears were just streaming down my face, and I'm going, I can't understand this, I can't do this. And he said, he reminded me, that's why they hired you, because you can't do it. And, you know, again, it wasn't that hard. You just describe what you see without lapsing into that impenetrable language, you know. Yeah.
I ask a question about what you do when you talked about a first draft, and you said all those cliches are fine.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do with those? Do you let them land and then deal with them, or do you bat them away as your?
I try to bat them away. I mean, they're very tricky. They can get right under your radar. I mean, they're very good at it. But finally, you know, and maybe it takes the second draft or the third draft or the fourth draft to kind of root them out and get rid of them. But and sometimes you never do. Sometimes you just kind of convince yourself that it's not a cliche. I mean, one of the reasons to have other readers that you whom you trust is because they can say to you, or an editor, this is a stale use of language, you know. But I, you know, there was this kind of frightening case that happened not that long ago, and it was a young adult novel, and there was a woman, she was an undergraduate, she was a Harvard undergraduate, who was accused of plagiarizing another young adult novel, and it was in the papers. This is like 10 years ago, and what scared me was that all the things she was accused of plagiarizing were cliché, were the same clichés. Like, you know, if you say his eyes were as dark as night and somebody else did, you're plagiarizing? No, you know, you're just gonna... So, you know, I felt terrible for this young undergraduate senior whose life was ruined, you know, who knows, for doing this, but neither of them should have written that way. Yeah.
Well, I was just going to comment on the cliche thing with, I teach undergraduate writing, and I think a lot of the usage of cliches among young people is partly because they're learning to get their own voice, and they don't yet know something's a cliche because they haven't actually heard it that much. And to them, it's actually a fancy way of saying something. A lot also of what you were saying with this impenetrable prose that people produce, I think is, you know, people imitating. I mean, that's what writing is for young people. That's how you learn to do anything, really, right? Is you imitate. And a lot of them are aspiring to be, I mean, I even felt it in the Donna Tartt thing that you read, is she's trying to write like a writer, but she just is failing.
Yeah.
I haven't read that book, but I don't plan to. And you helped solidify why I won't, but, you know, I
saved you 800 pages.
But I try and, you know, beat it out of them. For instance, that there's this equation, partly because of how they've learned to write for the SAT and different things, the AP exams, that, you know, you have to have incredibly long sentences, you have to have really long words, multiple syllables, even when you're not using the words properly and they don't fit in that context. And the idea of simplicity as being actually sophisticated or beautiful is not there at all.
I know. And, you know, again, I mean, I remember seeing some TV, it was like on PBS, and I was, you know, watching it during the day, and it was a show that was aimed at middle school teachers, and it was teaching them how to, sort of the language to teach kids. So there was a video of clouds, you know, going through, and what you were supposed to teach kids to write was the clouds scudded across the horizon. I thought, scudded? Really? I would never use that, you know, if someone put a gun to my head. But that was what you're supposed to... So I think kids are getting... You know, you're right. They haven't heard enough or read enough to know that these are familiar, that they've seen it all over. And then they're getting the wrong cues. And they continue to get the wrong cues because, well, to just return to poor Donna Tartt for a moment... when everyone was praising the book, and in fact the Pulitzer judges, whoever they were, the reason she got the prize was for her beautiful use of language.
But then, that's also goes back to the question, I guess, the reason is I, when it comes to writing a kid, I'm about to write something that I'm obliged to for the first time. And it goes back to this cliche, what do you do with those kids when they're doing those cliches? You know, is it something to work through, or is it something to back away? You know, is that a way in? Is that something to be refined, or is that something to just avoid? You know, if you're doing a first
draft. Well, with kids, it's completely different anyway, because you have to be so delicate with them. I mean, you really have to, because, you know, I remember myself. I mean, I can still remember... and it gives me great pleasure, the art history section leader my freshman year in college, who just mercilessly ripped my paper apart, and when I was writing art criticism for the Wall Street Journal, the guy went on to become a curator, and I would think, I see him on TV, I go, ha ha, you know. but you have to be careful, you have to be delicate, because you say the wrong thing to a kid and they never want to write again. So you have to find a way of being gentle with them without being, you know, and still say you're not supposed to do this.
What about a first time writer who's not a kid? What would you say to them?
I had that experience because as a working journalist, my editors would always point out in the copy, in what we call blue mode, which is, you know, our conversation and things, so it can't be seen in print. They'd say cliche alert. And you have to go back and rewrite it. You know exactly what a cliche alert is. Because half the time when we write in cliche, and experienced writers do it all the time, is because we don't, when we are doing a first draft, you don't think of it. Mm-hmm. It creeps in under the radar, and somebody else reading it sees it, and just, it's simple. It's not accusatory, it's not anything. Right. It's just alerting you to it, and you have to rethink that phrase.
I think a lot of it, too, is just reading, really, just mm-hmm. opening yourself up and reading like a great deal of beautiful work.
Right.
I for the first time, started the Rabbit series by John Updike, and when we talk about language, holy moly, the Rabbit Run is not, it doesn't even have a particularly interesting plot, but the language of that novel is just riveting, and it's like, after I read that book, everything else, I'm kind of like,
I know that can happen. That can happen. But you know, but again, in answer to your question, people say, can writing be taught? Can writing be taught? The thing that can really be taught, no question, is line editing. You can teach line editing. I mean, you can't teach someone to have necessarily a sense of narrative, or necessarily an interesting sensibility, or necessarily, you know, you can help them with their observational skills. I mean, that you can help them, but you can't really make someone. But line editing, that is infinitely teachable. That is, I mean, one of the best teaching experiences I had 2 years ago, I was the Gabriel Garcia Marquez Foundation started this program in Colombia, in Cartagena, where they would bring 40 young journalists from all over the world. I mean, they were fluent in English and in Spanish. Africa, India, Asia, all over Asia, South America. And then they brought in a couple of older writers from, I was one, and there was a journalist from Bogota, and a guy from San Juan, and to help them line edit. So you can go through and say, you know, compress this, cut this, put a comma here, and it's not threatening in the way that it is when, you know, I mean, one of the troubles with workshop is, to me, is that often students don't know what to do with the advice that they get, and rewrite it from the dog's point of view. Really, I mean, it feels like such an attack often, because that horrible practice where the student isn't allowed to speak and is just sitting there mute, and you know, so it seems like kind of, it's horrible. But line editing, it's not particularly threatening. And it's clearly helpful. I mean, and you can do it. But the thing to remember, I think, about it is that it doesn't, what do I want to say? You don't get to a point where it's automatic, even for yourself. I mean, there's this great Isaac Babel quote, the great Russian, where he does say words go into hiding on the page. And you know, it's wise why you have an editor, or why you do have a friend you trust or something, because you can't see it anymore. And someone else can say, well, I mean, just, and in bigger ways, too. I mean, this novel that I just published, which is long, it's like 450 pages long, it was 300 pages longer than it is now, because there are all these different narrators, and I had some stupid idea that the narrators had to take turns, you know, that it had to be like a completely regular rotation, you know, well, even if they had nothing to say. And my friend read it and said, you don't have to do that. You know, all you need is the narrators who advance the plot, and you can just... And bingo, in one night, 300 pages dropped out of the book because it was just like blah, 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 because it was their turn. So, but I couldn't see it. I just couldn't see it, and I needed someone else. Yeah.
Well, I wanted to return to the idea you said. I think what distinguishes truly great writing from, you know, banal writing that is probably best avoided to read in the first place is this focus on language. Great writers, it's all about the writing, it's all about the language. It's not about the ideas. As you said, the idea for the John Updike stuff, it could be, who cares? That's not what it's about. But I remember when I was teaching middle school, in particular Tolkien and The Hobbit, and I was trying to teach seventh graders ideas about language, like alliteration, sounds, mm-hmm. Metaphors, similes. And they couldn't believe me. They really did not believe me that writers would consciously be thinking about the sounds of the words. This, to them, was kind of mind-blowing, because it's, for them, it was all about plot. It's just plot, plot, plot. And I think a lot of people, as they get older, they just never move beyond that. It's plot. That's what interests them. That's what drives them to read things, is plot.
Well, for me, honestly, I need both. Mm-hmm. You know, I need beautiful. I need language that's really satisfying as language. And then, I'm attention deficit disordered enough that I need a reason to keep reading, which is often, you know, in many cases, a kind of what happens next. I mean, not necessarily, you know, not with the rabbit books exactly, nothing happens. Or, you know, Beckett, you read Beckett and nothing. I mean, you know, the guy like transfers some stones from one pocket to the other. He takes a bicycle trip, goes nowhere. You know, but the force of the language is so amazing, and the originality of the language is so amazing that you're just drawn in, or that, again, the sensibility, whatever it is, you're just drawn into it, and it doesn't matter that nothing happens. Plenty happens. It happens on the page. It just isn't a car chase or something.
Who's done the best close reading or close style analysis of Beckett's prose?
I don't know, because I don't read. Okay, confession. I generally don't read criticism. I mean, I'll read reviews, but I don't. I just, life is short.
You knew enough to know that there was a void that your book filled.
What?
You. I loved your book, and I look for books like that in the grammar. Not I read grammar books, so I'm always looking for criticism. It does help my writing. So I didn't know if you have any.
I wish I did. I mean, there are people who write beautifully about literature. I mean, speaking of John Updike, his criticism is beautiful as well. He writes beautifully about literature. There's an art critic named Sanford Schwartz who writes for the New York Review of Books, who has written a collection called, I think it's called Artists and Writers, with some of the most gorgeous writing about literature in it. I mean, you know, and then writers writing on other writers often, you know, write the best because they're in the trenches, so to speak. So, but again, for the same reason, because of the jargon element, I can very rarely sit down and pick up a book of literary criticism and read it. You know, I'm like out of it. So, yeah.
Hi, I'm from West Virginia. I'm just going to preface that so when you understand. I'm writing a memoir, which I know is a cliche in itself, about growing up in West Virginia in the 60s. Mm-hmm. And I'm writing from my voice, a 10-year-old who's pretty smart but uses words incorrectly, like a lot of West Virginians do. Like I talk about contracting leukemia, or my grandfather contracted leukemia. So someone marked up this whole thing like, you don't contract leukemia. And then I talked about my parents.
Yeah, you do.
Yeah, I mean, it was just really harsh. Like, you know, my parents met in a chemistry lab, and the molten gases must have ignited their love. And, you know, that, you know, so should I just go on with the language that I grew up knowing, or should I try to help the reader and be more?
Well, at the risk of getting too personal, who was this person that told you?
He was someone who wrote a really great short story, but he's a nephew of a friend of mine, and we were just trying to share each other's writing. So,
you know what I would do? I mean, I would look for the thing that's closest to what you're doing. I mean, off the bat, have you ever read A Childhood by Harry Cruz?
Mm-hmm.
Any of you read this book?
Yes.
It's so beautiful. I mean, he grew up in rural Georgia, and it is so beautiful, and he manages to find exactly the right language in which to capture his childhood and the experience and the language around him. It just works perfectly. And just look at it. I mean, I think that it'll be very encouraging for you. It's a beautiful, beautiful book.
Okay,
I mean, it's
thanks.
Incredible.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I was listening to your language while you've been talking about things that you discussed today. And very often, the most often word that you've used was beautiful. You add some things like simplicity, gorgeous, the other thing that was lucidity was also there. And I was wondering if I play the advocate of the devil, how would you object to the possible idea that it is by itself a special language, a language that is already a jargon,
mm-hmm.
and this jargon had been created like 2 centuries ago. It is an aesthetic language, actually.
Mm-hmm.
The very insistence, the very strong insistence on beauty as the most important thing, as if it is something self-understandable, is something that comes from there, the mystery of beauty.
Right.
So what would be your objection to this?
Well, it is the most subjective word. And all beauty, what does that even mean, right? And also, not only that, but it's a word that's been, you know, intensely debated and has really fallen out of favor. I mean, it's funny you should say that, because just this morning, a friend, a painter, asked me to write a catalog copy for his catalog of prints he sent. And I use the word beauty in the third paragraph. And then I proceed to, like, basically apologize for it for the rest of the paragraph, saying, you know, I know this word has fallen out of favor, blah, 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 but I still think, you know, beautiful, blah, blah. And then, so he writes me today, and he says, okay, you know, really great, but would you mind changing the word beauty that you use three paragraphs above it just casually, you know? Because it's better if you qualify it in the way you did. I said, fine, you know, I'll change the earlier beautiful to surprising. Works just as well for me. But it's subjective, you know, what I find beautiful. But when, you know, if we're just, again, the goldfinch, if something is completely bogus and someone thinks that's beautiful, it's clearly not. I mean, it just is like complete, it's false. I mean, that, you know, I mean, beauty, what does it mean? There has to be some kind of something, if we're talking about language, something persuasive, something original, something that you haven't seen on the page before, something new, something, I don't know. Again, subjective, but.
Yeah, just one sentence. But you know that all those things are historical and they change, and a lot of theory has been done on this particular issue, how novelty changes into cliché, and how old clichés that are forgotten to be clichés become new things.
Right.
So in that sense, it has to do with fashion, with all those changing attitudes with regard to what is beautiful and what is not. So in that sense, I was a little bit puzzled with the categorical attitude that you have when you've been using this word beauty.
Some does. I mean, some changes. But then you look and say, okay, why does a Shakespeare sonnet still strike us as beautiful? It was written, whatever, 400 years ago. Language has changed. There must be something, you know, I mean, there's something about beauty remains a constant, just as we like to think, true or not, that there's something about human nature that remains a constant. There's something that's beyond fashion, beyond.
What struck me when I was getting confused about the cliches and where they land, and I act, and I know that there's a pass that you make as an actor when you receive usually scripts with words, but sometimes images, and you make broad strokes, and you whether you're conscious of it or not, refine those broad strokes into something clear. And I think clarity is perhaps more what the word, if there is a word that we're talking about, clarity seems to be the thing that ties experience between humans, and maybe beauty isn't necessarily a thing. I think when something is clear and of its own, when it's clear and universal but still of its own character, then that to me, I guess, is beauty.
Yeah, what would you do with Baroque, with mannerism, with Gothic literature and so on? There are a lot of periods of human aesthetic history that have nothing to do with clarity, lucidity, and this type of beauty that we have, we continue using after the Romantics. So in that sense, it's not that easy, from my point of view.
It's complicated. I mean, that's why, you know, I use the word, and if I'm not just talking but writing, I feel compelled to use the word and then just go on. But I think you're right. I mean, it is clarity. Clarity is hugely important. And then also, you know, if we're talking about cliches.
But even if it's mystery, and even if it's in a different code, even if it's in a different, I don't have the vocabulary to make the point, but even if it's in a different code or in a different language of a different age, I think, and even if it's not meant to be clear, even that notion, the way I understand it, it's respectful to deliver that in a clear way, even if it's not supposed to be clear, even if it's wrapped up.
It definitely varies by language too. I mean, I always emphasize about English that we value precision and concision, generally speaking, at least in the 21st century in English. And I know that's not true in different languages. I have a friend from Madagascar who tells me about her language, where everything is very flowery, and you know, describing a trip from walking here to the bathroom is all metaphorical, and it's very long-winded. But that's how they describe it.
But how do we know that it's clear to them? The path of communication is the communication is made. And okay, we might call it clarity, but the communication is made within that.
I mean, clarity is the writer's caring about whether the reader understands it or not, right? And that's what I think a lot of, say, undergraduate writers struggle with, is they have never thought of a reader. They've never written actually anything for anybody but a teacher. And of course, the teacher has to read what they write. But in the real world, no one has to read what you write, right? So you actually have to think about your reader. And I would agree, that's clarity, right? Thinking about your reader actually understanding what you mean to convey, which doesn't mean it has to be simple, but it has to be something they can figure out.
Comprehensible. I mean, it has to be comprehensible.
Maybe what we're looking for is like approachability or accessibility, just because, and like you said, it's so subjective, so that like when you read something, the reason you love it is because it spoke to you. And
right. Right.
And it hit you, it hit me differently in a way that it hit you, but we both loved it in different ways, and, you know, so I feel like there's a better word than approachability or accessibility, but it's, I don't know, it's just...
Yeah. No, it's you know, one of the reasons I was dodging those reporters after the Pulitzer was that I just didn't want to talk about... I didn't want to talk about that. You know, you think it's beautiful? God bless you. You know, I don't. And it's, you know, or... You know, you read The Goldfinch, and it's like, you think it's the best thing you've ever read, and it makes you a reader when you weren't a reader before. I couldn't be more grateful. You know, and the same thing goes for a lot of children's classics or books that I know.
Harry Potter,
absolutely. I mean, which is actually pretty well written, but, you know, books that my kids were forced to read in middle school. And I didn't think they were particularly good, but, you know, they responded to some, they didn't respond to others. You had a question?
Yeah, it's a little, I guess, I don't know, it's a different topic, but I wanted to know about when you're writing, you know, and if you, I guess my question was like, if you let language help you establish priorities in terms of your ideas, like if you have ideas, many ideas, or some ideas that are competing with each other, like, does language help you establish where you go first?
Mm-hmm.
Or how do you sort out your priorities in terms of your ideas?
Well, you know, I say, and people think I'm joking, but I'm kind of not joking, but I don't have any ideas. I just don't have any ideas. I have, you know, what do I have? I have a desire to be as clear as possible, and I have a desire to tell a story. Mm-hmm. Those are the two desires I have.
Mm-hmm.
Ideas, you know, yes, they work themselves in, but the ideas come later. The ideas come later. They, you know, it never, ever, I can say this with some degree of honesty, nothing has ever started with an idea. It has never started, so, you know, someone tells, you know, I mean, you read the journals of Henry James, and he goes to a dinner party, and somebody says, you know, someone I know was a governess for two insane children, and there were ghosts in the house. And then he goes home and writes The Turn of the Screw. I mean, you know, I mean, you read Henry James journals, you think, boy, he got invited to better dinner parties than I'm going to. But nonetheless, you know, you just train yourself. You just hear something or you see something, and it stays in your mind. I mean, for some reason, it just nags at you and nags at you. And maybe a year later or 5 years later or 10 years later, you just can't get rid of it, and you start writing something. But but for me, I don't, you know, I can't speak for anyone else. I really can't. But for me, it's always something very concrete. It's
always something very,
very
what?
Concrete. Very particular. You know, not, I mean, you know, this last book, this is my new book.
What do you mean, an object or an
art? An object, something I see, some little bit of a story somebody tells me, something that happened to a friend, something I notice on the subway. you know, a little bit of narrative, I pick up somewhere something I overhear, but it's never, I mean, this new
a
book,
person.
What?
Also a person.
A person, yeah. This new book, I mean, actually does deal with the problem of evil, but I only realized that when I was sort of 100 pages into it, that's what I was writing about. And then my poor students, my little guinea pigs, I taught a class on the literature of evil, so that, you know, we started with the Book of Genesis, and we worked our way up through Beowulf and Macbeth and so on and so on. So I was looking at how that problem has been just kind of turned and turned and turned in literature and looked at, but that's not how it started. You know, I never thought, I want to write a book about evil. That wasn't how it started.
I've just got back from, I've been traveling a few countries in Africa, and I've got to write about it. And all I've come back with is ideas.
Mm-hmm.
Is it, you know, I'm in that I imagine very familiar place for most writers of kind of wanting to start, having all different ideas of how to start. Would you recommend that it's about finding that object, finding that one thing, that one concrete thing, that one foundation from which to spring from? Or is it a case of throwing paint on canvas?
Or noodles against a wall.
Yeah.
I don't know. And again, you know, I'm always hesitant to be prescriptive.
I understand.
I'm always, because what works for someone, but I can tell you, I was writing a book, Lives of the Muses, and it was 9 mini biographies of these women who are muses. And in each case, the only way I could start was to pick one incident, one narrative incident that seemed emblematic of the whole story. And then I would work out for them. I mean, I'm writing now, it's complicated, but it was partly because, why did I agree to do it? Oh, because I just couldn't stand to leave the world of the novel that I finished. So I agreed to do this biography of Peggy Guggenheim. And I couldn't think of how to start it. I just couldn't. And then when I went to her, to Venice, to see her collection, she's got this statue of, this Marini statue of this guy on a horseback. And so it's a very abstract guy, horseback, huge penis, sticking out at the Grand Canal. And I thought, oh yeah, that's Peggy Guggenheim. So it gave me a place to start and a way to talk about her character. But again, concrete. You know, it wasn't abstract. I mean, the statue's abstract, but it wasn't abstract. It was a very particular thing. But again, you know, I mean, you look at great writers, Montaigne starts with an abstraction. And I mean, I would kill to write as well as Montaigne. I can't. But he starts with abstractions, not with concrete.
Thank you.
So.
I have a question.
Yeah.
When you write your novels, do you have a fairly good idea of what your plot is, where it's all going, or do you sort of write in to your story?
If only I did, I would have fewer unfinished novels in my desk drawer because I would know where I was going. I mean, I have friends who write outlines. I know there are writers who write outlines. I envy them. Amazing. You know, they know where they're going. I mean, I had a friend once call me up and say, I finished my novel. It's 244 pages long. I thought it was going to be around 240. And I went, that's not my experience. Again, it worked, you know, the novel was quite good. He knew where he was going. For me, it doesn't work that way. And as I said, I kind of wish it did. I mean, maybe I don't wish it did. I sort of wish I did. You know, because, well, who said, you know, no surprise for the writer, no surprise for the reader? It's full of, I mean, one of the reasons I like writing fiction is because there's so many surprises in it. I don't know what's going to happen. I literally do not know what's going to happen. And that's part of the pleasure. I mean, nonfiction, you have the story, and you just have to figure out how to tell it. Fiction, you don't. And you hope it works out.
You don't.
No, and in fact, you don't know where you're going in an essay. I mean, and it's why, you know, if somebody asks me to do like a magazine article, and then they say, well, could you send us 2 paragraphs about what you're going to do? It's always harder to write the 2 paragraphs than the essay, because I find out often what I think by writing the essay, and the paragraphs, I have no idea what I'm talking about, what I would even begin to be talking about.
Yeah.
but even with nonfiction, with personal writing, where you think that you have a plot or something in mind, memory takes over or consciousness takes over, and you go off into a tangent, and it's the journey which is enjoyable.
Yeah.
You may cut it out, parts of it later, but certainly for a first draft, it takes you in all surprising directions.
I know, that's the beauty. Oop, there I go again. No, that's the joy of it.
the mystery.
The mystery.
I have a question.
Yeah.
You had said the key to a character is a language he's using inside his own head, and I'm curious of some examples of your favorites, like books that you can think of where there's an internal dialogue for a character that really shows who he is.
I'm trying to think off the top of my head. Well, I can give you an example. I mean, I know from my own. Well, you know, because my memory doesn't go any further back than the, you know, I mean, the novel that just came out. It begins with a series of letters that the photographer is writing home to his parents in Hungary, as Brassai, who the character is based on, did. And I wanted the language to be kind of like the language in the original letters, which is affectionate, boastful, asking for money without seeming to be asking for money. You know, and again, I was interested in this photographer in this situation, and then I was also interested in the relation between grown children, that oxymoron, and their parents. Another novel that comes as an example. Complimentary toilet paper. That's a perfect example of weirdness coming through language. I can't think of specific examples, but I know that in nearly every case, some phrase would pop into my mind, and I think, okay, I can do this now. When I didn't think I could do it before. And it was always about language. It was always about language. Yeah.
In answer to this lady's question, how about Virginia Woolf's Mrs. Dalloway, where you are inside the reach of the character's head, and you're listening to their internal monologues, so to speak.
And it's all internal monologues. I mean, it's different internal monologues. But, you know, that was, I mean, the great modernism, that's where it began. I mean, last year I taught this class. It was a big mistake, I'll never do it again, and it was called Ecstasy, Hysteria, and Obsession, because I've been reading a lot of literature. I've been rereading Proust, I've been reading Turgenev and Wolf, and then I started reading all this Freud. I just got this desire to read a bunch of Freud case histories, and what struck me was that all these situations in literature, you know, excessive love, inappropriate attachment, blah, 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 especially like Turgenev, say Turgenev's First Love, then Freud came along and medicalized these situations and set out to cure people of the things that Swan experienced. But you know, the great thing that Freud did, and that, I mean, Freud and Virginia Woolf lived at the same time, was to call the unconscious to really deal directly with the unconscious, which is, in a way, what literature had always been dealing with. We just didn't know that's what it was. So yeah, internal monologue. You know, how we talk to ourselves in our heads. It's like eavesdropping. I mean, a lot of it is like eavesdropping on your characters and just hearing what they're saying to themselves. Linda.
I wonder about a book like Catherine Boo's Beyond the Beautiful Forevers, which I have to say I really did enjoy. But it seems as though, just listening to you, I was thinking about the difference. She's a journalist and spent all this time in Mumbai. And a lot of the wonderful wording in it is not original. These are things she really heard. And it seems that there are more journalists doing this kind of writing now. And I just wonder if you have a comment on that as a fiction writer, that in some ways, it's a little bit easier that you're listening to something and then something comes around and you're doing something very original. I think this is less original, and yet it is very enjoyable reading.
Can we be perfectly honest? I mean, I really hated that book. I really, really hated that book. Yeah. And my Indian friends, apparently she toured India, and everywhere she went, it was like people were just outraged. And she just blew them off. Because why? Beyond the Beautiful Forevers, you know, this book in the Mumbai slum. First of all, speaking of writing, I mean, it just seemed like it was just, it was again full of this language, you know, that just didn't mean anything. You know, the moon smeared sky, you know, stuff like that, like, ugh. But also, I found it sort of, you know, yes, she was writing about the poorest of the poor. She gets a lot of credit, as far as I'm concerned, for you know. But there's a lot of internal consciousness of these people who are living in this slum in Mumbai. And I found myself thinking, you know, she's taking such huge liberties. What someone had in his mind, some, you know, Mumbai slum dweller, had in his mind 10 years ago. And I'm thinking, how does he really remember? Do you really remember? Are you making this up? Where you get? I mean,
she's
working through a translator in any case, for sure. And the cultural gaps are huge. But again, I had this, where are you getting this feeling? And I didn't, you know, and I felt sort of badly about it because it got, you know, was hugely successful here and hugely popular and won all these awards. And so when, in fact, doing this Garcia Marquez thing, there were a lot of young Indian journalists, there were like five of them, and they all said, that's the worst book I've ever read. And I felt, you know, you'd never want to hear this, but I felt weirdly confirmed in my feelings about it. And then they would tell me these stories about her appearance in Mumbai or Goa, or, you know, where she traveled, and people rising up from the audience. And then the sort of offhand nastiness with which she blew them off. That's all I'm going to say.
There's a writer I'm reading now, Delicate Dallas.
Or his mystery. It's a wonderful book.
And there you believe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's right. Yeah. I would just go there.
Yeah, and also he gets inside those characters' right. heads, and you're exactly. totally persuaded by it. I know.
Was the Beyond the Beautiful Forevers, which I'm not familiar with, I mean, is that, did you say it's journalistic? Is it supposed
it's journalism.
To be, it's claiming to be
nonfiction.
True?
Nonfiction.
Okay.
They were original thoughts.
Yeah. Well, I think it's interesting, perhaps because we're here at the Public Theater, also to think about Mike Daisy and what went down with his story about Apple and China and everything. Because, you know, once it was on NPR, and it was later discovered that certain things were not actually factually true or whatever, there was this whole explosion. And I wrote a piece defending it and saying that I thought, you know, first of all, I think everything is so subjective, even journalism, what you choose to include, what you don't choose to include, that I think also fiction is truer than nonfiction. In a weird artistic way. But I feel like I was the only one who taught that. Everyone else was just slamming, they wanted to crucify Mike Daisy. But I don't know if you have any thoughts on that. Did you see his performance at the Public Theater?
No. What was it? I don't even know. I'm not sure I even know the story.
I can't remember what it was called. Ecstasy of Steve Jobs or something.
Yeah.
But it was about, basically, and it's so interesting to me his work was kind of the impetus for people or organizations like the New York Times to start covering in more depth. They had done it superficially, the conditions in factories where things like iPhones and iPads and all the electronics that we have are made. And so Mike Daisy, who's an amazing performer, he does one-man shows, and he doesn't really have a set script, he has notes. But basically, you know, slamming the creation of this product. And he had gone to China and done a bunch of research, but also worked through a translator. Anyway, it made it to NPR, and that's when it got really big. And then it was later discovered that he had fudged some of the details. Mm-hmm. Like, was the girl working at the factory actually 12, or maybe she was 14, or maybe she was 11? Who knows? But to me, it was like, it doesn't matter. The point is, this is a child. She shouldn't, in a good world, this wouldn't be happening. But basically, everything was discredited once a few details were called into question. And NPR retracted the story and regretted having aired it. And actually, it was very interesting to be at the Public. I saw it a second time the day after this happened, when NPR retracted. And the show went on. He said, you know, why not? And the Public stood behind him.
Well, you know, my feeling about that, I always feel like they wind up making a fuss about the wrong thing. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, the New York Times, speaking of the New York Times, I mean, after Judy Miller basically lied about the weapons of mass destruction, right, and hundreds of thousands of people wound up dead who wouldn't have been dead if that hadn't happened, or, you know, it was you know, it wasn't completely causal, but it didn't help. And they fired her, blah, blah, but, you know, she... And then, like, what, a year later, 6 months later, that kid, Jason, I can't remember his last name. Yeah, you're right. Writes this thing about the, you know, Mississippi, whatever, and they totally crucify him. They do, like, pages and pages of apology and so forth. And I'm thinking, I don't really care that much about what he made up. I really care a lot about lying about the weapons of mass destruction, but that somehow didn't get the same, they didn't seem to be as upset about it as they were about this other story. So, you know, in the same way, I mean, do I care whether James Fry spent 3 months in rehab or 1 month in rehab? Not at all. I could really care less. But the huge lies that have been told in newspapers about things that have really mattered and where life and death has been at stake, I care a lot about that. And those seem to be the ones that don't get there. One of the classes I taught, and I really liked it, although I finally got tired of it, was it was about literature and lying and journalism. And I had my students, their weekly assignment in this case, was to take the same story and read it in the New York Times centrist newspaper, the UK Guardian, and some right-wing newspaper of their choice. And I mean, I said of their choice because it was often harder to find international stories in right-wing newspapers. But, and then I just asked them to write, again, speaking of language, the way in which language was used to slant a story in these different newspapers. And it was great. I mean, it was really interesting the way they started picking up on stuff that they didn't pick up on before. You know, like, what was his name? Jose Padilla, right? The, you know, the guy that the, you know, the terrorist, who has been, you know, rotting in Guantanamo. I mean, whether he was described by one newspaper as Jose Padilla, by another newspaper as former gang member Jose Padilla, or a third newspaper as suspected terrorist Jose Padilla, those are three different ways of describing the same character, and right from the beginning, gives you a different slant. One of my students found this amazing thing it was the Times, and it was a piece. It was when South Dakota was going to pass a really restrictive anti-abortion law, really restrictive. And the Times did this piece by a woman journalist who I'm sure didn't even know that she was doing it. But there was part of the story was written in a, I mean, again, language, right to life, right to choose, you know, right there, it's a problem. But nonetheless, so she goes into the right to life headquarters, and all the women who are working in the right to life headquarters are young, blonde, healthy, their children are playing and they're by their feet, and they're, you know, calling people and supporting the law. I mean, they couldn't be more, they're like poster women for right to life. And the women in the right to choose headquarters are old, childless, as far as you can tell, angry, you know, blah, blah. And you read the story, and if you didn't have any opinion, you think, obviously, the right to life is the way to go. Well, because it was the way it was slanted in the piece, you know, regardless of what, and it could have been written a completely other way. So, you know, there's a lot of it. And I kind of felt great to teach this class because I felt that my students at the end of the semester were better equipped to read the newspaper, to find out what they were being told, and finally, to be members of a democracy, which you need. You know, you need to be able to analyze whether what you're getting is propaganda or what kind of propaganda. It's helpful.
Very often it's just subliminal. You know, the story doesn't do it, but they will change. The editors can slant it by the captions they write.
Or the photo?
And the photographs.
Oh, I know.
Choose. That's very, very common.
Well, I'm sure you all remember, right after Katrina, there were two photos that ran, I think, in the Times, and with people with, you know, stuff they'd gotten, and the African-American family was looting, and the white family had found food for their family, you know, looting versus finding food. Two different ways of describing the exact same thing that had happened. So, you know, and again, it's a language choice. Yeah.
I keep thinking one of my favorite books, I don't know why, is Marilyn Robinson's Housekeeping. And I read it at a time when I'd found a relative who had been missing for very long. And I just cried through the whole book. But one thing that I really loved about it, and also was kind of weird, is the amount of time she spent on talking about how damp the climate was, mm-hmm. and how the leaves and layers of leaves and damp. And I was thinking, wow, this is going on a long time. But then, you know, when she got then into the book, you realize that that was a metaphor for how trapped this mother felt. And
yeah, it's a beautifully written book. I mean, the fact that the town is called Fingerbone, isn't that right? I remember, like, right away, you know. Interesting choice.
Would you say there's more responsibility to a writer to be more accessible now, because a writer is competing with methods of storytelling that perhaps they didn't have to before? You know, the literature from, you know, when I read Shakespeare, there is something universal, no doubt. But for a modern ear, it requires some effort on one's part to understand some things. It's, you know, a writer writing contemporary, whatever, prose, poetry, whatever, do you feel a necessity or responsibility to be more accessible because you're essentially competing with film and television and the internet and, you know, the myriad of things we're now using?
I try not to think about, you know, and also I should say I'm a big TV watcher. You know, I mean, just give me a great serial, you know, Breaking Bad, The Sopranos, The Wire. It's fantastic. And it's an art form.
But I don't mean it as a negative thing. I mean, I don't mean it that
right.
But I mean, there is, you know, that's a fact that you want to share your story with someone.
Right.
You've got to put it into just language, you know. Is it something you think about? You don't.
I don't think about it.
But there's not a single person, probably. I never find anyone who thinks that the movie was better than the book, right? Everybody always thinks the book is better.
Oh, there's a few.
The Godfather. The Godfather. The movie of The Godfather is a million times better than the book.
Midnight Express. Much better.
Okay.
It happens. No, you know, I do think, I mean, I think it's very hard now to teach. It's very hard to teach kids for that reason. Because, you know, my 3-year-old granddaughter would, like, pick up a book and try and swipe it. But I also think that the way reading is taught, I mean, I think teachers, you know, grade school teachers, middle school teachers, high school teachers are heroes, no matter what. I mean, they're heroes. To do that work, it's, like, you know, amazing. But I also think that somehow people have lost sight of why it is that people, of kids, why they might want to read. I mean, I just had this experience within the last 2 weeks, which is my older granddaughter, who's 7, who can read. She doesn't really like to read. And I was looking at her books that she brings home from school, and she's got to read these books. You know, they have to progress through these levels, like, you know, chapter books, blah, blah, A, B, C, D levels. She's reading these books, and they're kind of boring. I mean, I just look at them, and they're just like, you know, the what did blah, blah want for her birthday, and what did she get? So I started reading her The Witches, We're All Dolls, The Witches, which is a terrifying book. I mean, she was so frightened she could hardly move. I was so frightened. But for the first time, she said, I read like 4 chapters at once, and she said, read me another one, because she wanted to know what happened next, you know, which had not been her experience with these books that she was assigned to school. And I thought, bingo, you know, kids are like, they're so protected from, you know, if you taught The Witches to her first grade class, her teacher would lose her job. I mean, the parents would be calling in, da da da. You know, she's related to me, so I'm not going to. It's okay with her parents, my son. and then by accident, we were driving to the city. I was in the back with her. My son was driving, and I was reading her in the car. And then by accident, I left the book in like the seat pocket of the thing. And I called my son and I said, oh, I left the book. And he said, yeah, I know. He said, I read her another chapter that night because she asked for it. And it was like the first time this had happened, because it was that. It was like, what happens next? And also because there was an element of fear involved. So I think that's important to remember. You know, you can protect kids, but on the other hand, suspense and terror have always been part of children's literature, and it's just getting leached out of it by I don't know, I hate, you know, political correctness, whatever you want to call it, I'm protecting them. And it's a pity, because I don't think it's helping to create a generation of readers.
It's terrible, and it's at every level. My daughter was teaching seniors English in a high school in the South, and she told them to, being a totally new, inexperienced teacher, she suggested Catcher in the Rye, because she loved it, and she thought it would get these kids who were not in the least bit interested in being in school to read. And she was called into the principal's office because it was a proscribed book.
Really?
She couldn't teach it, and she it was very
a what?
Hard. Proscribed. It was not allowed. So I said to her, what are you going to do now? And she said, well, I'm getting them to read Romeo and Shakespeare. I said, these kids who have never read anything, how are you going to get them to read? She said, I told them there are lots of dirty passages. And then the success of it was that she didn't read it. She assigned the parts, so the kids were acting it. It turned into a very dramatic class, and it went down extremely well. She made readers out of these kids who were not going to read. Even Catcher in the Rye would have been hard for them. But they read the Shakespeare, because the school hadn't thought to Baudelaireize the Shakespeare edition.
Right,
Shakespeare is fine. They were so short-sighted that they didn't realize that what was in there.
My question is, how many of the students ended up reading Catcher in the Rye because they couldn't?
Yeah.
Do you know what's interesting about that, though? When I've just been traveling a few countries in Africa, and I sat and spoke with the Batwa Pygmies in Uganda, and they have the same distrust or I don't know, whatever we as people who like literature have of, you know, us mourning some kind of loss of literature. You know, these are people who were storytellers by mouth and by touch. And there's a kind of, there's a distrust of literature. There's, you know, I wonder if there was a meeting like this however many years ago where people were saying, oh, you know, the kids are now writing things down and not talking to each other.
Right.
You know, so I guess it's interesting. It's interesting.
Well, there's an oral tradition in all societies.
But what I'm saying is that it's just storytelling. So I mean, this is a whole other discussion, but it's just storytelling at the end of the day. If someone's reading it, or they're writing it, or they're watching it, or they're even texting it, you know, it is just storytelling. And I wonder if, I guess it goes back to my, I guess it's really, I'm asking myself a question. I wonder if there is a way of writing now that, and maybe it's already happening, but there's a way of writing now that in some way embraces a child's mind in the way that those other things are. I don't know.
Well, I think that the desire to find out what happens next is pretty, I hate this expression, hardwired. I really think that. And I think that when you appeal to that, it's something very basic about people. Storytelling.
Well, you have to be able to cope with what happens next, so you have a vested interest in it.
Yeah. Anything else? Pressing questions? Things you've always wanted to ask?
What did you think of Donna Tartt's first book?
I liked it.
Yeah.
I liked it, fine. Yeah.
I asked this of Toni Morrison a couple of years ago, and she dodged the question. American authors always do, because my question is, when is an American going to win a Nobel Prize in Literature? I mean, if so, who should it be? So she gave
you. Can
you
speak up a little bit?
Yeah.
I can hear you.
So when will an American win the Nobel Prize in Literature again? It's been since 1993 when Toni Morrison won, so it's been more than 20 years. And if anyone remembers, about 5 or 6 years ago, someone on the jury from Europe basically said it's because Americans are too provincial, and they only write about America, and they don't think about the world, which of course we know is not really true. But who are the people who should be winning? I mean, I have my candidates. Some of them are dying off. Of course, once you're dead, you're not a candidate anymore.
That's a great pity. Do people read Mavis Gallant? I thought Mavis Gallant, you know, when I was in Toronto last fall, and A friend of mine, a Canadian writer, said, isn't it great that Alice Munro won the Nobel Prize? And I said, yeah, it's really great. And I think it is really great. I mean, she's a great writer. And then the silence fell, and my friend said, I know what you're thinking. And I said, really? What am I thinking? And he said, you're thinking Mavis Kellogg should have won it. And I said, how did you know what I was thinking? And he said, because I was thinking the same thing. And then we said, isn't it terrible that we should be forced to choose between two great Canadian women writers? I mean, it's a, you know, but she, I think she's, was equally as great as Alice Munro. You know, there are plenty of great writers. I mean, Philip Roth, of course, is always talked about, and I think he's a great writer. I think he's a great writer. Whether or not he'll win it, I don't know. But that's just bogus about Americans being provincial. Where are they getting that? Yeah.
But the reason why I think, you know, a lot of people would dismiss the Nobel Prize and say, who cares? I mean, Philip Roth himself has said that. Who would turn it down? But, you know, it gives you a cover in the same way that Shakespeare does, being so old and esteemed. 450 years ago, he was recently born, right? A couple weeks ago. 450 years. So you can read Shakespeare, you can teach Shakespeare, and people, schools are not going to ban it. And the same thing with the Nobel Prize. I mean, Toni Morrison does get banned in schools sometimes, but it gives you that extra legitimacy, and it gives you that extra reach that, you know, we all know Philip Roth, but there's plenty of people out there who've never heard of him, right? Mm-hmm. And once you win the Nobel Prize, actually, you reach all these new audiences. That's why I think it does matter.
It does, although there are plenty of Nobel winners that no one reads. You know, Elfriede Jelinek won it not that long ago, and I happen to like Elfriede Jelinek, but I understand she's not everybody's cup of tea, and she's not widely read, so...
Doris Lessing.
She won it last year. Anything else?
I guess.
Yeah.
Oh, go ahead. No, really, go ahead.
No, I'm just going to make a comment on your question because I guess following your logic, you know, because I'm Colombian, mm-hmm. I'm going to preface that. And we won, Leonardo Colombia won once the Nobel Prize and it really, like the Literature Nobel Prize. And it really changed things for the country in a way, the way it was viewed. You know, mm-hmm. It was kind of put in the map in a different way, even before drugs and all the other things. So, I thought that your question was interesting just because, you know, someone from other places in the world would say, like, well, you know, when my country's gonna win. Mm-hmm. So just, you know, I just wanted to make a note about that.
Yeah.
So, because for us, it was such a, nobody will ever think a Colombian's gonna win a Nobel Prize again, you know. So.
But it also happens that writers from other countries, by some miracle, suddenly get well known here,
get discovered.
I mean, Roberto Bolaño is a perfect example.
The best example, a genius.
You know, and also he had, you know, the only good luck, as far as I can tell, the guy ever had was to get great translators after he died. So he had two great translators into English, Chris Andrews and Natasha Wimmer, and he was just turning out these works. I mean, 2666 is one of the great novels of the century. It's
or Nasib Mahfouz, you know. And there's something to be said for international writers winning it and not having an American every 10 years. Why?
No, I agree. It's just 20 years is a very long stretch, especially like between 2003 and 12. I think the European won every single year. Maybe there's one exception. But I think you can definitely see a European.
Not European. Most of them are actually from other parts of the world.
Yes.
They're Indians, they're from Trinidad and Tobago, and so on and so forth. It's not that they're Europeans.
And it should be. It should be widespread because, you know, many of these writers never get translated unless they are.
Right. You know, the sad statistic is that under 400 books a year get translated from other languages into English, including technical manuals, including probably how to put your, you know, air conditioner together. So, and it's a pity. But it, you know, but that's again, we're getting into the sort of the forces of the marketplace, which are disgusting. So, so that's a whole other question. But you know, lately, more recently, even than Bolaño, Karl Ove Knausgård, who is an amazing writer, is only now being translated into English after having become the most famous writer in Norway ever since Ibsen. And people are reading it. I mean, it began with writers. Or Peter Nadas, the Hungarian writer,
yes.
Not so widely read, a great writer, people should know about.
Yeah.
or Peter Esterhazy, another hunky writer. I mean, you know, they're out there. They just aren't getting here. Yeah.
This may be off subject from what we're talking about, but it seems to me that within this group there are teachers and there are writers, there are journalists and so on. I see, and I'm none of those, but I see that what we're living in today is a bullet point type of society, that an anti-intellectual society. And how do you make literature that means something to people about life, about living and so on, accessible to everybody, rather than just to people that, you know, and this is, it gets back to the problem of what we're doing in schools today and so on, but literature to me is very important, understanding, and the use of language as you're talking about, and the use of feeling. How do we get that across? So I see very downside to our future society and our future democracy with what's happening without all of this. And how does literature fit into that? And how do you make the literature accessible?
I couldn't agree more. It's really scary. I mean, but you know, I'll say this and I'll just sound like the most paranoid person who ever lived, but I think that for the past 30 or 40 years, that we've been purposely undereducating the population. I really do believe that. And it's certainly, I mean, you can see it even in New York City. The fact that Mayor Bloomberg abolished universal pre-K, it was a crime. I mean, you should be prosecuted for that rather than reelected or reappointed for 12 years or whatever you did. You know, the fact that you had to, I mean, again, to talk about my own family, my granddaughter goes to public school in Brooklyn. The only way she got into pre-K, because in her neighborhood it was completely crowded, was my daughter-in-law basically camped out in the office of the school and begged for a place, and she got in. Now, if you don't have the resources, the time, the energy to do that, your kid doesn't go. I mean, de Blasio's bringing it back. You know, if he does nothing else, that's fine with me, if he does nothing else. But I think it's not accidental. I just don't think it's accidental that they've been defunding or, you know, creating charter schools which are privatizing education, et cetera, et cetera. I don't think it's accidental. I think that there's been a certain desire to create a workforce that's not educated beyond working in the McDonald's or working for below minimum wage or you know, so forth. I think that's on purpose, and I think anything that any of us can do to counteract that is really important. I just don't know. I don't know what to do. I mean, I work with a program. I go into the schools in the Bronx, and the kids, I mean, it's kind of great. I mean, it's as important for me as it is for the kids I'm talking to, because by the time I leave, I always feel more optimistic. I mean, because the kids are smart, they're motivated. This is like, you know, a school way up in the Bronx, and this is like the honors class, but still, you know, and they are determined to go to college, whatever. So, you know, whatever any of us can do, but we're fighting a system that doesn't want that to happen. I think, you know, it's hard, but it's worth doing.
But it's sad the people who are proponents of the charter schools. I think they've accepted the idea that you can't have public education, which is better.
Well, the ads for the charter schools, you know, are really gross. I mean, you know, they're destroying my education. Well, yeah, and they're taking a certain amount of money away from public education to, you know, so. But it's a whole other discussion. All right, anything else?
What was the name of the Norwegian writer?
Karl Ove, K-A-R-L-O-V-E. Knausgaard, K-N-A-U-S-G-A-A-R-D. The book's called My Struggle. It's a 6-volume memoir, autobiography, novel, who knows what it is. And it's great. The 3rd volume is about to come out.
My Struggle.
Yeah, and I mean, calling the book My Struggle, or Mein Kampf in Norwegian. What am I doing next? Well, I am praying that this book tour ends before it destroys me. And after, I'm doing this little Peggy Guggenheim biography, trying to finish it. And I have a sort of idea for another novel, but I can't I just can't do anything, so I'm just trying not to panic. That's what I'm doing now. Thank you all. It was a great day.